Because I want to talk a little bit about John Dewey and his influence on the ethical culture movement. Now, John Dewey was a professor at Columbia University for many, many years, and the ethical culture community has also had a very deep connection with Columbia University. Felix Adler went to college there, and then he taught for many years in the philosophy department. And his son-in-law, Fries, also was chairman, first chairman of the Department of Religion. So John Dewey and Felix Adler and others were part of the faculty in the philosophy departments and the religion departments at Columbia University. And even Joe got his PhD in comparative religion, was it?
In the religion department, in religion.
Religion department from Columbia University, and has taught for many years human rights law. So there was sort of a professional and a friendship relationship. And then I'd like to turn it over to Joe to talk a little bit about, because he spoke earlier about the philosophy of Felix Adler and the beginnings of ethical culture, but it did evolve over the century. So Joe, why don't you
This moves us away from the activism into a philosophical history of philosophy discussion, I guess. Yeah, I did talk in the session before last on Felix Adler's, actually the last session, on Felix Adler's technical philosophy. And those who participated might recall that I reviewed the fact that Felix Adler was technically what you call a philosophical idealist. And idealism was the major philosophy of the 19th century, and it flourished in what's known as continental or European philosophy, centered around Germany and so forth. And when you look at idealism, I guess the grandfather of idealism, for those of you who studied the classics, would be Plato. And the prevailing notion of idealism is that ideas, in effect, possess a reality that the material world does not. As Plato referred to them, ideas are what are really real in a way. Now, that sounds counterintuitive. How can ideas, in effect, be more real than material objects? But idealists hold, as did Felix Adler, hold to that position. Okay, now, Felix Adler also felt that ethics and ethical values and ideals have to grow out of these ideas that are created by the processes of our mind. And in that sense, I should say he did not consider himself a humanist. He thought that humanism, where ethics may grow out of human experience, what is most practical for us, may grow out of the social and material conditions we find ourselves in effect, was too self-referencing. In effect, ethics can only come from an appreciation of transcendent ideals, okay? And we have to hold those ideals in reverence in order to guide our behavior, and not earthly considerations or the human condition or human psychology. Darwin, in as early as The Origin of Species, 1859, was an evolutionary psychologist. He felt that morality grows out of basically natural selection and the evolutionary process. And you could see proto-forms of morality in various developed animal species, the apes and so forth. Adler would have none of that. He felt Darwin was a brilliant scientist, but was not a proficient ethicist, because ideals could only come from above, from those supernal, transcendent ideas that are generated by the mind. And again, not earthly dynamics and mundane concerns and human relations or the human experience. Okay. Now, many of his early followers in the 19th century came from German Jewish backgrounds. Many of them were members of Temple Emmanuel, okay, or had dual membership and so forth, including the first president of the New York Society, Joseph Seligman, who was one of the wealthiest Jews in America and in his 70s, and Adler was in his 20s. Adler was able to command a great deal of respect, but many of the early members, my point is here, came from that same Germanic background with a quasi-mystical appreciation for ideas and ideals and gravitated, or at least were positively responsive to Adler's very high-minded philosophical idealism. Okay. Now, what happened, as I interpret it, is the demography of ethical culture, and we're talking here about the New York Society primarily, began to change. In the late 19th, for the first few decades, the centerpiece demography, demographically and ethnically, of the New York Society was Jewish and German, okay? Emphasis on the German here. But with 1881, you have the beginning of the great waves of immigration from 81 to 1924, when you had millions of immigrants flooding into New York from Southern Europe, Italians, and Eastern Europe, especially millions of Eastern European Jews. Many of them came with socialist backgrounds. I mean, the prevailing, it's interesting, despite the appearances and optics, the prevailing philosophical orientation of Jews in Eastern Europe between the two wars was not Judaism, it was socialism. Okay, which flourished in that part of the world in various manifestations. Many of these people were poor and they came over here, and a good number of them gravitated to the New York Society. Many of them were fleeing not only the Tsar, but also rabbinical establishments in small villages in Eastern Europe. And a good number of them, Jewish and others, gravitated towards the New York Society. And I would argue it changed. They brought with them their socialism. In some cases, their Marxism. They brought with them their religious skepticism, maybe their secularism, and so on and so forth, so that the prevailing body of the New York Society began to shift. And with it, it created a climate for the shift of philosophy. You had on the philosophical plane, Felix Adler's idealism was very much a 19th century philosophy that hit a dead end in the United States. It flourished again in Europe in the 19th century, but did not take root to any great extent in the United States. It was superseded with what was understood to be a specifically American style of philosophy, namely pragmatism. And there were three great American pragmatists. Among them was Charles Sanders Peirce, who didn't write very much. The second was the great Harvard philosopher and psychologist William James. And the third was John Dewey, as mentioned. And Dewey was probably the most influential. He had taught for 10 years at the University of Michigan, then the University of Chicago, and then came in the early part of the 20th century to Columbia, and basically was the chairman of the philosophy department in the golden age of Columbia University's philosophy department, and so forth, in the 1930s and 1940s. And Dewey produced a lot of acolytes, a lot of disciples, okay? And what happened was really, he was very close to ethical culture, and Dewey was in effect an explicit, self-identified humanist. He was also ethically speaking and philosophically the paragon of what we call philosophical naturalism. That is a belief that nature is all that there is, and there is nothing outside of nature. Felix Adler didn't quite believe that. He believed that outside of nature, there was something, okay? It was basically impersonal. It was austerely impersonal. And it had some inkling, some relationship to what we would call the divine. Dewey would have none of that. Dewey believed as a humanist that our ethics come out of practical human conditions. He basically believed that the human condition creates frustrations and problems. We use our imagination, our mind, to frame ideals that come out of the human condition. That's not where ideals come from for Felix Adler. They come through the basic fundamental processes of mind, going back to Immanuel Kant. For Dewey, it comes out of practical problems. We frame ideals to imagine a world that is not, that could be, and then we use those ideals to try to close the gap between the way the world is and the way it could be or ought to be. And we use those ideals to resolve our practical problems. We use our intelligence, hopefully collectively, to resolve problems. And once we resolve this problem, we move on to the next problem. For Dewey, life is a succession of problems, and our life is really a series of problem-solving exercises and events in the service of greater satisfaction. That's Dewey's, in a nutshell, okay, is Dewey's humanism. And it could very well be argued that if the philosophical person from Mars were to come down to Earth and witness the ethical culture movement, he or she or it would conclude that the implicit philosophy of ethical culture from the 1930s on, including contemporary ethical culture, is implicitly John Deweyanism. Okay, Dewey's philosophy is what we in effect prescribe, even if we don't make it explicit. And ethical culture will state over and over again, we do not have an official philosophy, but you got to come from somewhere. Okay, and I would argue that the ethical movement is implicitly Deweyan. Ed Erickson, my predecessor, wrote a book on the humanist way, very much a humanist. He's very much a Deweyan. And he basically, I forget his exact line, he said, ethical culture is the movement that Felix Adler created, and his descendants were basically, and John Dewey basically was the philosopher they were willing to accept, okay? That we shifted from an idealist, German idealist philosophy to a naturalistic humanism. And that's where we are philosophically today. I should say that one of the catalysts in this was the leader whom I mentioned before, and that was Jerome Nathanson. Jerome Nathanson was explicitly a Deweyan, spoke about Dewey from the platform all the time. He gave addresses frequently on Peirce, that triumvirate of James Sanders Peirce, William James, and most of all, John Dewey. He did not have much of a taste. He started in the early 1940s, did not have much of a taste for Adler's idealism, and so on, and helped convert ethical culture to a Deweyan philosophical perspective. I should also say what also helped us along the way was Adler's appointed successor, and that was John Lovejoy Elliott, okay? As Richard implied, Adler sent Eliot to Germany to get his doctorate, okay? And you know what? His doctoral dissertation was not on some high-minded philosophical investigation. Eliot's dissertation was on prison reform in Germany, okay? And Eliot really represented the ethical leader as social worker, okay? Not as philosopher. He was not a Felix Adler, although Adler recognized that he had strengths different from his own. And, you know, he helped create, he did found the Hudson Guild over 100 years old on West 26th Street. And that was part of our movement, we should mention. And that was in Adler's day earlier on. In the early years of the 19th century, he did found three settlement houses in New York. They're still around. Hudson Guild is the largest and most best known. Eliot lived in Hudson Guild. He didn't live uptown. He lived with the people he served and was very involved in terms of working with the working class, a great deal of work with immigrants. He worked with guys who were sent away to prison, okay, and had a sympathy and concern and support for people who were incarcerated. Very different style from Adler. Adler was an activist, but he was not a barricades activist. Dewey was a barricade activist. If you're a teacher and belong to the union, and enjoy the benefits and perquisites of the union, you can thank John Dewey in great measure for that. He marched with teachers on picket lines. Adler would never march on a picket line. He gave speeches and talks and so forth in lots of different places, but he was not a barricades activist. John Lovejoy Elliott was, and we could argue John Dewey, the philosopher, came down from the ivory tower at Columbia to speak to the working class. He was the paragon of public intellectuals, and he was also an activist. He was on picket lines with teachers, helping to organize them. So in effect, it's an interesting transition in ethical culture from Adler's high-minded idealism to Dewey's more practical, down-to-earth, pragmatic, gritty activism and so forth, and philosophy, which I think we still represent today. Richard, I hope that's an adequate presentation of the evolution.
Yeah, that's really wonderful, Joe. Thanks a lot. And in the 1960s, there actually was a meeting of leaders where they sat down and decided, yep, we really are John Deweyites. And there was an accept acceptance of the word humanism, which Felix Adler had eschewed so much. So at that time, at the end of the 1960s, several societies actually changed their name to Ethical Humanist Society.
Right. It was 1965. It was a paper that was drafted by Ed Erickson, who was very much an identified. Ed is still around. He's in his 90s, lives in Florida. I need to give him a call. He, in effect, was a humanist, wrote The Humanist Way, and developed a paper that was reviewed by the National Leaders Council. It was then called the Fraternity of Leaders, basically identifying ethical culture for what it was in practice for several decades, as implied, that is a humanist organization. And it was done under the leadership, primarily given the imprimatur of Professor Joseph Blau, who was a leader in the ethical movement, mostly as a volunteer, served on Long Island. But Joe Blau was also a professor of philosophy at Columbia. I knew Joe. I was his last student at Columbia before he retired. I took a seminar with him alone, a tutorial with Joe Blau. I forget when it was, a long time ago, probably in the 1970s. But Joe was a lovely man, very erudite. He was not so much a technical philosopher as a historian of philosophy and wrote books on the history of American philosophy. He was also the first person to write about Reform Judaism in America. He was the first person to write about, in a scholarly way, about Reform Judaism, Joe Blau was, but he was a leader in our movement, and he gave his imprimatur. It was under his leadership that the ethical movement, as Richard points out correctly, the leaders came together in 1965 and basically endorsed a paper written by Ed Erickson that identified ethical culture as a humanist movement, but their understanding of humanism, and I think it's a good statement, I've read it, was a very broad understanding of humanism, not so much a reduction to particular doctrines or principles, but more of a sensitivity and orientation in life that had many different streams flowing into it, right? And it's a very good statement if we can get a hold of it. I think it's very useful today. But Richard is right. We did identify ourselves as a humanist movement. Adler was not, again, spurned the notion of humanism. The title, the word, the concept of humanism, because he thought it was philosophically wanting. That's not where our values have to come from. It's not where our ethics comes from. It's not out of the human experience that they emerge. They come from the supernal realm, again, of transcendent ideals, which from Adler's point of view are perfect and we need to strive for. Okay?
Well, that sort of leads to what our next program would really be. So if our ethics comes from our experience, how does it affect our personal experience? And how does it affect our lives and the way we live? What does it teach us? And how do we cope? And that's going to be the subject of our next and last session in this series. There may be a contradiction where we look for answers and humanism says they come from within. And is that really helpful? I mean, or not. There are some wonderful things to read. We talked about Ed Erickson a few times here today, and he wrote a wonderful book called The Humanist Way, and that is available from the AEU. And we have it on Sunday mornings when we remember to bring the books out. And I'm really glad we have Joe Palau here down there on the bottom of my screen, because Joe wrote a wonderful essay summarizing ethical culture in a way in about 8 or 10 pages. And I'll try to make that available if Joe doesn't object. Because anyone who wants to take a look at that, it's a wonderful summary of putting ethical culture in a context, in a philosophical context. Joe himself is also a PhD in philosophy. So,
Richard,
there
he
is. Yes, sure can.
Yeah, I wasn't able to get my face and my voice on at the same time. I would just like to put a plug in for Howard B. Radist.
Yes.
I think that Joe could say more than a few things about Howard. But
go
honestly,
ahead, Joe.
Dr. Schumann can. But all I want is add here is that he contributed to the ethical movement, was a wonderful doyen, accomplished academically, and quite a natural doyen, meaning when he gave a talk or teaching a class, he had Dewey, in all his pores. and of course, the work he did at the schools and an effort to get Dewey back into the classroom. Joe, you may want to say more than that.
Well, yes, I do. I think for people who are interested in the history of ethical culture, we can't end this session without introducing what is the only history of ethical culture, okay, in the United States. Everybody should read this book. You can get it through the AAU. It's entitled, everybody should know this, Toward Common Ground, and it was authored by Howard Radist. Okay, he wrote this in the 1960s and 70s, right as he was becoming the executive director of the American Ethical Union. Howard was trained in philosophy at Columbia. Interestingly enough, Joe Blau, whom I mentioned before, who taught at Columbia, was actually Howard Radist's high school history teacher. Howard grew up in Rockaway, and Joe was teaching high school at that time in Rockaway, and Howard was a student of his. So you have generations. But Toward Common Ground is the only, it's about 300 pages long, is the only history of ethical culture that's extant. It's riddled with a lot of details. Howard went into the archives and went through the minutes of the New York Society and other societies to write this book, and so forth. And it begins at the beginning with Ethical Culture's founding by Adler in 1876, but it ends basically in the early 1960s. So in effect, I remember when this book was new, but it covers virtually only half of the history of ethical culture. Nobody has yet written the second half of our history. We're still waiting for that historian to do that, but it's very good at covering ethical culture in our golden age, okay, some of the conflicts. And Howard is not, basically, he's not a cheerleader here. He's very, very objective, and basically is very, comes out very, with a great deal of honesty and integrity in terms of outlining ethical culture's faults as a way, and its problems, not only its achievements. So it's a very reality-based history, and I recommend it. I mean, you have to really read this if you want to garner an understanding and information about the history of ethical culture in the United States. It's Howard B. Radist. It's Toward Common Ground. And I'm very proud to say that when this was reproduced not so long ago by the AU, they asked me to write a preface to this new edition, which I was able to do, summarizing very briefly where I think we've been, where Toward Common Ground leaves off in the early 1960s. Okay, so Toward Common
also
Ground.
Also, a couple of other things. Yeah, a couple of other things about Howard Radist. He was a recognized leader in health ethics of medical ethics. He also was a teacher of ethics at the Ethical Culture Fieldston School, and he was the first dean of the Humanist Institute, which was a joint venture between Ethical Culture, the Unitarian Universalist Humanists, the American Humanist Association, and Humanistic Judaism. Those four organizations together cooperated in the creation of the Humanist Institute, which lasted for about 25 years.
It did. Howard was a very interesting personality. He was not warm and fuzzy. He was an intellectual. But he was an interesting combination of the intellectual and the institution builder. Howard believed in institutions, and he felt that if humanism in its various manifestations is going to survive, it will only do so because it is built upon the foundation of sturdy institutions. He took that very seriously, and as Richard has implied, he was a type of ecumenical humanist that was willing to work and happy to work in coalition with a variety of different humanist organizations. He absolutely believed in the humanist project. There is no doubt about it. He believed in humanism, and he really expended much of his life in the service of creating humanist thought and humanist institutions. He was also the president of the International Humanist and Ethical Union for a good number of years. I served on their board for about a dozen years, but before I did, Howard was one of three presidents of the IHEU representing the American Ethical Union. By the way, I should mention that the AAU was one of the founding organizations in 1952 of the International Humanist and Ethical Union, and it's in effect, it's incorporated right here in New York City, even though its headquarters are based in London for many years. So we were part of that as well, okay? International Humanism.
So we have a couple of minutes left. If anyone has any questions, comments, concerns, objections, arguments. Did I leave anything out?
Right. Anybody have any tomatoes to throw? You can't do that on Zoom. That's one advantage of Zoom, right? Your tomato won't hit the target. Any questions? Any
well,
thoughts?
It's impossible to mention everything that's happened in the last
it's been
century,
a rich history.
But...
You know, let me just say, I think we can be proud. We're a very small organization, very small. And I think our contribution to American society and progressive social justice has been far disproportionate to our size. I mean, that we can say. I mean, we're not the only one. I mean, as I tried to point out in my first presentation, ethical culture and its founding was part of what we called the progressive movement. We were one among many organizations that were trying to undo the evils of the Industrial Revolution. We weren't alone. But ethical culture is we can take a great deal of pride that our contributions have been thoroughly disproportionate, much greater than our size.